There was.
It's a series of puzzles.
Even when it's beyond that, it was 100% linear, which is fine. But that's the way the game is designed. But Fallout is like, all right, here's the world, go. And you could
do what you want to do.
You can go in any direction you want to go, and obviously there are places you can't handle yet, so you just got to decide, I'm not going to go there yet until I get my skills up a little bit. But it's also the other thing the more recent version of it that I really liked is even when you get to like your maximum level, you could still be somewhat challenged by even the lowest level creatures that you.
Well, that's because the concept that they have now that companies are using is that you enter the world at a relative level, and then the whole world levels with you. So no matter when you meet something, it's always going to be a certain amount of levels higher or lower than you.
Yeah.
So in other words, each encounter is deemed, this one is supposed to be on a scale of 1 to 10, how hard or easy is it going to be?
Well, it wasn't that. It wasn't that it was just everything scaled with you. It's just that the power curve was not that steep, so that when you it's not like in some games, like one problem I have with games like World of Warcraft is something even a little bit advanced beyond where you are, you have absolutely no chance against. And once you get just a few levels beyond a creature, you can almost ignore it. There's a very short window, and you really need to be fighting something that's almost your own level, you know, give or take one level, in order for it to be a good fight. Whereas in this game, the first level easy creatures, they don't get more powerful with you, but you never become so powerful that you could just ignore them.
Yeah,
they become easier and easier for you to defeat, but if you like don't pay attention to them, you can get overwhelmed by them even when you're at the highest level. And I like that. But it was also just the fact, and not only is the game non-linear, to get back to that, but you could actually solve the game in multiple completely different ways.
There
isn't one solution. So it's non-linear in that respect as well. And I really wish that more video games would take that approach. It's harder. It's more difficult to write games that way. But I think it's much more rewarding where you're actually making decisions that affect your character, his relationship to the world and to the game, and the possible ways to solve or to advance your goals in the game.
Yeah. All right, Evan, did you say what game you like?
No, but that's all right.
We're good?
We got Brian. Yep.
Oh, yes.
So we're actually going to use headsets, Jay, so that we can avoid the whole...
That is awesome. Are we putting them right over our mics?
Why don't we just shift these down?
Hello?
Shift what down?
The headsets.
All right, again,
I don't have
while
one.
We're technically getting Brian back on, I will mention that our sponsor for this hour is David Young. Actually, David Young sponsored the next 3 hours. We're going to actually try to Skype him in during this period of time. So we'll wait to discuss that until after the Brian interview. Is he ready? Yeah. Brian, you with us?
Brian.
I see him. I do not hear him.
This is Brian Dunning, and you're listening to Skeptoid.
Hey, Brian, how are you? Sound great.
So are we just having audio problems on his end?
Yeah, I guess so. I can't hear him at all.
Okay, so we're just having general audio problems with Brian right now.
Yeah, Brian, we can't hear you. So getting back to David, let me read a little bit of...
Profone, how's that?
Oh, here we go. There we go.
Profone, how's that?
Can you hear me?
Yes.
Profone, how's that? Can you hear me?
Yes.
Profone, how's that?
To hell.
Oh. Yeah, I've never heard that before.
Nope, we got a loop. We got audio from Brian when it was looping.
some people are saying they can hear Brian, but not SGU.
Yeah, everybody heard that echo.
Hello, hello?
Yes,
yeah,
hello.
Right.
Hello, hello?
Yes, hello.
Brian.
Hello, hello?
Wow, we're getting a three echoes. I've never heard that before.
Wow, we're
four echoes.
No, it's just continually echoing now.
How's that? Can you hear me?
Yeah. Hey, Bright.
Brian, do you have a headset on?
Brian, we heard you good. No echo, but now you're not hearing us. Oh, he's texting us now. Brian, can you hear us? Uh-oh, it's not working. I think that's Brian typing, isn't it?
Yep.
It sounds like it.
I heard someone.
Hey, Brian.
Hey.
What's up? Can you hear us?
I can hear you now, yeah.
Okay, good.
Okay.
Here we go.
Oh, we're good. All right.
Am I echoing still?
No.
No, that's better.
Okay. I guess I'm ditching the headphones then.
All right, well, thanks for joining us, Brian. What's it, like 4 o'clock there?
It is 4 o'clock in the morning, yes.
SGU is quiet, they're saying.
I'm too quiet?
No,
you're fine. I think we're too quiet.
Oh.
Let me,
I can't help you there.
Turn up SGU.
All right, let's see what the guy says. Got to crank up the SGU.
All right, they say we're fine. So, you were chatting to us before we brought you on about the Church of Scientology item that we were talking about, that there are exceptions in the law for religious workers.
Religious workers, yes.
Yeah.
yeah, I don't know much about it other than it's the same kind of laws that allow nuns and monks to be basically full-time unpaid or paid way below minimum wage. You know, obviously that brings us to the whole question of, is Scientology really a religion and do they qualify for that? But, you know, I think their religion is as valid as any other religion.
Yeah.
So, but I think that's, if someone is trying to sue them on that basis, I think they're going to lose because that's, they for whatever reason, for right or for wrong, they do qualify as a church, and so they are going to be able to get away with that.
Yeah. Yeah, we've had this discussion before about the difference between a cult and a religion.
Yeah.
So in terms of what Scientologists believe, yeah, it's easy to poke fun out of it. It is absurd, but that's okay. Just because your belief seems absurd to somebody else doesn't mean you're not a legitimate religion.
Right.
But we can talk about the practices of Scientology. Are they abusive? Are they totalitarian, etc.? And you know, there are certainly a lot of accusations against the Church of Scientology for engaging in that kind of behavior.
Yeah, and I don't know what this particular complaint is. Are they being abusive in such a way that violates whatever these rules are? And that may well be the case, but I don't know. I just,
yeah,
that was my one little thought on what you were saying.
Yeah, I agree. It's a story that we're going to have to follow just to see how it develops. It may go nowhere.
Should I be able to see you guys or not? Because I can't see you guys.
You should be able to see us. You can also, can you look at the stream? And you can see what's being streamed.
Oh, in the little typing window thing here? I don't know. I don't want to rock the boat. Oh, there we go. Yeah, I don't care. I'm happy.
Okay. Did you get a look at the set, though? the skeptic.
Oh yeah, I did. I was watching in a browser window before we came on. So I closed that just to save bandwidth because I'm in a hotel here.
Oh, I see.
I'm totally amazed at the set. I had no idea you guys were actually going to go to all this trouble. So
neither did we.
You gonna do it again next weekend?
No.
Is it proving to be as much fun as you'd all hoped?
The show is great. The Skepta Lair kind of took on a life of its own.
I will say, am
the
I
end result is fun.
Green, red, that's kind of cool. I will say I was listening to I don't know which episode, a recent episode, and I finally agreed with Jay on something. He was saying you guys should start after you wake up in the morning when you're all freshly rested and ready to rock and roll for 24 hours. And the rest of you were saying, no, at the end of the business day when we're all ready to crash, that's the best time to start a 24-hour show. So,
well, it was the difference between what's the best time to start the show and versus what's the best time to end the show. So, yes, it would be better to start right upon waking up, but then the show will be over at 8 o'clock in the morning. And we'll be essentially have shifted our sleep cycle by 12 hours. Whereas this way, if we can manage to stay up, then we'll be able to go to sleep at the end of the day and be pretty much right back on schedule.
Well, maybe you can find someone who's a doctor who can prescribe some Ambien for everyone and knock everyone right back onto schedule.
Or some melatonin, right?
It would have been a good way to start the show too. See who can last the longest.
After
get
taking
everyone up
Ambien.
With Ambien and Xanax, start the show, see who's on their feet an hour later.
Right. That's gonna be hard enough. The other thing is that we were working furiously to get everything functioning in the hours before the show went on. So we would have had to have gotten up a few hours early at least before the show started just to do technical stuff, you know?
This is the kind of thing that would have been a great idea in college. Before everyone's in their 40s and 50s.
Someone suggested on the chat window, just take some homeopathic sleeping pills. Someone else pointed out that you just called us old. Yeah, you did do that, didn't you, Brian?
I'm right in there, too. I'm 45. I'm not calling anyone old that I'm not willing to be called myself.
That's true. It's okay if you yourself are old or nearly so as we are.
Thanks.
So, Brian, Skeptoid remains a extremely popular skeptical podcast.
Thank you.
I do occasionally look at the iTunes rankings and things like that, and you're always in there. So how have you been able to sustain it for this long?
Well, I set myself a goal early this year of trying to make it a full-time job by the end of the year, and I'm probably not quite going to make that, but it is on a curve that's achievable. It's all the listener support is. It doing Skeptoid occupies way too much of my time to be able to do to remain something that I can do on the side, because it's not just writing the podcast and engineering the podcast. It's supporting the website and the blog.
Right.
And there's a ton of stuff, and it's definitely a full-time job. So I, for better or for worse, I stepped up the reminders at the end of the episode that it's a listener-supported program, and here's how you can support the show. And I guess my support program is similar to the one I've seen on your site. You know, people can subscribe for, you know, basic rate of 99 cents an episode, like iTunes, and they can go up from there if they want to donate more. And I'm in the process of converting it into a 501c3 because I've had a lot of feedback from people that say, hey, I'd rather give my money to a charity than to Uncle Sam, and you know, you're near the top of the list. So that's going to be exciting, and I've got a pretty good, pretty thorough business plan and plans for what to do at different levels of income, and so I'm hopeful the next year is going to be pretty exciting. It's about time that I be able to actually stop having to do a day job 8 hours a day, which I don't have anymore.
Well, we've chatted about this a lot offline, you know, that the fact that doing a weekly podcast – it is a full-time job, and it's not, it goes beyond just doing the research, producing the content, doing the technical production, but there's a lot of support that goes along with it, maintaining a forum, other social media, trying to produce other supportive content, and going to conferences. It's hard to do it like just a little bit on the side and actually be successful at accomplishing your goal, which in our case is promoting science education and skepticism.
And community engagement is also
a tremendous amount of more work than you think it is.
Yeah, I actually have to Twitter all day long, for example.
Yeah.
And that's not a fun thing. That's a business thing. And even that takes time. You've got to find something worthy of tweeting, and maybe write up a small blog post to support it. So just the community engagement aspect is half time right there, or easily could be if you were doing it well. I'm not able to spend enough time to do that part of it well, but I sure wish I could.
Hey, I got a couple of listener questions.
Okay.
Brian, people in the chat room are asking questions. One of them is, Brian, do you have any weird or crazy feedback that you've gotten from listeners of your show?
Nope, never really had any of that. I was, for a long time, I was somewhat infamous for my listener feedback episodes. There's a lot of low-hanging fruit that comes in. People who are obviously crazy or and they just send some really wild feedback in, accusing me of being a reptoid and all that, and being quite serious about it. And I would do listener feedback episodes basically just kind of making fun of them. And these episodes were really, really popular. The problem is that got increasingly, there was an increasing schism between what I was trying to make the show about, which is a positive educational resource that everyone can enjoy, and, kind of going the whole shock jock anti-crazy person route, which was fun and people enjoyed it, but people also enjoyed the other kind of show, and there got to be this schism. And so the last time I did one of those, I did one live at the 250th episode party earlier this year. I did a listener feedback episode live, and it was over the top as far as making fun of crazy people.
Yeah.
And at that point, I just decided, that's it. I'm going to stop. I'm not going to make any more episodes like this. And so I'm going full bore in the positive direction now. I'm not going to have any more episodes that I wouldn't be glad to put in front of a classroom full of kids. I mean, that's really kind of the dividing line for me.
Yeah, I've always thought that like your show fills a very specific niche, and it does it extremely well. You take
Thank
one
you.
Topic, you do a fairly definitive treatment of that topic in a short, concise format, and so it is what it is, and it works very well. Whereas, our format is very, very different. We sometimes contain within our show a very similar type of thing, where we will take a topic and deal with it. But we do tend to format our show more around like having a discussion or a conversation and dissecting the claims of of specific people, sometimes responding to feedback or to questions or challenges, like our Name Not Logical Fallacy segment, where we take something that somebody sent us, or just published in a blog or otherwise online, and then dissecting it for logic.
Yeah, our two shows, I think, are good examples of same content delivered in very different ways,
right.
And they're both valuable in their own right. I mean, I listen to Brian's show when I'm doing research. I've used Brian's show as a point of research for me for our show.
Yeah.
Do you give it proper? Is it properly credited on the show?
Never. No, we always just steal it outright.
I frequently get emails from people saying Skeptoid and Skeptic's Guide to the Universe, the two podcasts I listen to.
Yeah.
I get that all the time. I have for years.
Well, you can see on iTunes, like when we look at our podcast, say people who listen to your podcast are also listening to, and it's the Skeptoid always comes up in the short list.
Yeah, vice versa.
Hey, Brian, another quick question from people that are in the chat room.
See.
They want to know what you do for a living, and they want to know if you've had voice training.
Voice? No, I have not had anything resembling voice training. And what I do for a living is mostly Skeptoid now. What it was before is I sort of had a my background is in computer science, but I never really did anything computer science related. I did more of what it developed into was I called software venture consulting. I would work with small businesses who were trying to, it's like an example would be a dentist's office, and the dentist had made himself some little template to use in Excel or whatever the heck it was, saying, oh, I want to sell this to other dentist offices. I want to become a software company. And I would consult with them on whatever basis they needed the most help with, whether it was funding, setting up a whole company, just doing software development, kind of a whole range of services. It was a really unusual little niche. And I still have one or two clients that I've been working with for years and years and years. And that's basically what fills the rest of my day. And it's it would be nice if I could do Skeptoid full time, I'll just say that.
Brian, someone just typed in, they said that they bought your books and they're sitting on the toilet and they're well read and well loved.
I am so glad to hear that. Perfect bathroom reading. That's what I always say.
That is fun. I'll tell you, I do some of my most serious reading in the bathroom.
I do my only readings.
That's why I love the iPad so much.
Yeah.
I almost always have it, you know, in grasp when I'm heading into the bathroom.
Definitely, my iPhone is that for me. It's my Insta reader. Yeah.
Yeah. I like where you ended that sentence, Steve. I have the iPhone in grasp when I'm headed into the bathroom.
Yes.
No further comment.
That's right. You could use your imagination from that point forward. But, you know, part of the SGU 24 show is that this is a fundraiser for the SGU and everything that we do. We need to ask for sponsors, and we do encourage our listeners to make a donation while they're listening. Do, you know, what you said, you could do a one-time donation, or you could be a supporting member and do a recurrent donation. And, yeah, the reality is that it's a lot of work and resources to produce this. And we follow pretty much a PBS model. We produce the content for free. We put it out there for free because this is outreach. This is, you know, we're trying to change the world, right, make it more skeptical and scientifically literate. But for those who believe in our mission and appreciate our content, it really helps to support it financially. And what we do with that resource is we produce more content. We are actually trying to expand the number of people who are working with us and for us beyond just, you know, the five of us on the show to develop a real company that can produce media content and that could accomplish a lot more than just the five of us can. So it really is all getting put directly to work, you know, creating skeptical content and promoting science education.
And you guys have, because there's five of you, you have a much bigger hump than I do to get over.
Yeah.
To get to the point where you guys can really devote yourselves more to creating that content in order to, you know, warrant the larger contributions. So it's a tough row to hoe, as they say.
It is. I mean, you know, we're obviously developing multiple business models. You know, not while we... I think actually our biggest single revenue stream is just listener support, but we're certainly trying to develop other streams as well to get us to that point where we can actually start to offset some of our day jobs, if you will, or even just, you know, expand the pie, hire more people to do more work or people with specific skills that we don't have.
Yeah. Boy, that would be nice.
With the number of listeners that both of our shows have, Brian, I mean, really a small contribution by a large number of people could really make a big difference. And, you know, we happen to enjoy producing this kind of content, and people seem to like it. And that's why, you know, we ask people now to make, like, the reoccurring monthly donation. It's very simple. I mean, I absolutely support the podcast that I love. One of my favorite podcasts is... you know, we just interviewed Jad Amon-Rab from Radio Lab.
Yeah, I heard that.
I absolutely love his show. I'm passionate about it. I'm very emotionally involved in that show, and I donate money because I love it so much.
Chad does a fabulous, fabulous job producing that show. He really does. You know, again, he's able to do it full time. And who's to say that our shows wouldn't be as cool as his if we had the kind of resources he's got available?
Well, you know, he definitely has a different format, and he's going for a different thing with his show. But the fact of the matter is, like, yeah, it is a full-time job. He has a limited run episodes per year. You know, Brian, we're doing weekly content. It's a big deal to do what we're doing. We couldn't make a massive change in our show unless we had a lot more time. And unfortunately, time absolutely does equate to money, so.
Yeah, unfortunately, someone needs to solve that for us.
Well, Brian, you're actually doing better than anyone, as far as I know, and all the podcasters that I talk to, other than, of course, Jad, who's working for a company, you know, and he's using that infrastructure to get his funding. But, you know, you're doing grassroots, we're doing grassroots. I mean, we're definitely doing better this year because we've been really focusing more on revenue, and, you know, I'm putting ads and everything that I can and all that. We just completely dropped we don't want ads on the website. We're going to put ads in the podcast and everything. We have to do it to continue now.
Yeah, there's no choice. The donations are, I'm similar to you. Donations are by far the lion's share of the income, and things like, I've got ads on the website. I don't have any ads in the show except for my own show. But I've got ads on the website too, and that's, you know, it's still only a few $100 a month. It helps, but it's the kind of thing that can be optimized, you know, if you throw enough resources at it. And I've got some friends inside Google, and I've been told, gee, I should be making, you know, 5, 6, 8 times what I'm making if they were done better. That's the kind of multipliers like that are what you need. Most podcasts, I think, who are trying to make money at it, trying to do a full-time thing, they're a factor of 1,000 away, and we're a factor of single digits away. And so,
yeah,
we're both doing, I think very, very well, relatively.
Yeah, and this is definitely a conversation that we would need to have offline to get into real detail, because we definitely should be telling.
Let's share it with everyone. Let's share all of our tips and secrets with the whole world.
Well, I don't think we have any secrets, to be honest with you. I mean, that's the one thing we don't have is the secret way to make this, you know,
that's right.
Make money. If someone out there does have a secret, they should be sharing it with us.
Brian
just said something really
right
interesting. He said that Google told him that he should be making X times more than he is.
Do they know how to make money?
Of course they do. but they. I wish that they would just tell us podcasters what to do. Someone at Google, please inform us.
Well, I get the sense that the disconnect is, I think there are businesses who have the business model but don't necessarily have the content. And here we are, we have the content because it's genuine. You know, we love the material, we love skepticism and science, we live and breathe this material. You know, we've been doing this for years and years, so we have the background. You know, we put in the time to produce the content because it's a labor of love. But, you know, none of us, you know, have the business savvy of somebody, you know, who's making millions at Google, right? So you know, we need to get those two pieces together.
Yeah.
And that's what's been challenging.
Yeah, that's the top of my hire list. Should I get to the point where I can hire employees? I'm taking a very pragmatic view about that and making sure that sustainability and survivability as a company is job one.
Yeah.
Because you've got to be able to do that before you can start producing the great content.
Someone tweeted, essentially, do volunteers in Africa make money? I guess saying, if we're doing what we love and we're doing a good cause, why is making money a concern? So I do want to clarify, no one here is talking about personally making a lot of money or getting rich. What we're talking about is the more resources that are put into skepticism as a movement, as an endeavor, the more we will be able to do. I can't tell you how many times people tell us, oh, you guys should do X. You should do something. You should produce this kind of content. You should go to this venue. And this would be a great way to have outreach. You know, you should produce more content for the classroom. You should 100 things. And we agree. We should do all of those things. We're not doing them because we don't have the resources. We have a finite resources of time. You know, at this point, every dime that we get is none of it's going to us. It's all going to getting more resources to produce more content.
Mm-hmm.
There are lots of people that we're plugged into that could also be contributing specific skills or time or whatever to producing content and whatnot. If we could afford to compensate their time to do so, for example.
Mm-hmm.
So in any case, I mean, just to clarify, we're talking about getting the resources to do more. Not just, why aren't we making money doing what we're doing?
This has never been about making money to buy a yacht with. I mean,
I wouldn't.
But, the fact of the matter is that with the numbers that are in the science and skeptical community, we could be much better funded very easily just with a little more donation from our listeners and everything.
Yeah.
To really hit something hard, like I spent so much time building this set at the expense of my relationship with my soon-to-be wife. I'm getting married next week.
So Jay's getting married 1 week from today.
From today.
Wait, so why did we schedule this a week before his wedding? I still don't remember how we came to... All right, never mind.
Well, the point here is that, I'm sacrificing a lot of my personal time to do these projects and everything. And because I'm an activist, I'm driven to do these things.
This is a terrible way to make money. We have proven that.
Yeah,
that's definitely
I could
true.
Make more money selling ice cream than doing. It's not about the money, trust me.
Yeah, it's just as a movement, we want to be well funded and have the resources. The anti-vax movement's well funded. The intelligent design movement is funded to orders of magnitude beyond where we are, and we're arrayed against all of these forces simultaneously. We're not a single issue movement. There's a lot of money in snake oil and woo.
Yeah.
When we're going up against power bands, for example, they have hundreds of millions of dollars. All we have is just our passion and the truth.
Right. They are always going to have the economic machine behind them, because people are always going to want to pay for crap before they're going to want to pay for something good. This is a point I've been trying to make for a long time. That if anyone expects the skeptical perspective to start making grounds, it's got to be commercial. It's got to be commercial to do so. People have to want it.
Right.
And take, for example, the amount of time and resources it took you guys into doing what you're doing right now. Look at the set. I'm sure you've got a bunch of people helping in various capacities. That needs to be happening full time for example, the company I have envisioned. And that won't happen full time if you have to depend on everyone donating their time and their efforts.
Don't do it.
First of all, it's a violation of the tax code for one thing. People can't donate their services to a nonprofit. They can only donate cash or property. So we won't be able to tell people. You're already a 501c3, aren't you?
Well, the New England Skeptical Society is a 501c3, yes. The SGU is a separate entity.
Okay.
Yeah, we had to open up an LLC in order to get our show on XM.
Oh, that's right.
Yeah.
Yeah. Here's a question that came through the Twitter feed. What would the SGU love to work with Brian Dunning on that you haven't yet? So they want to know what sort of collaborative project should we be working on together?
Video production, absolutely.
I was going to say porno, but that's a better answer.
But Brian, you gave a more specific answer, because there's different kinds of video. We could, and we'll talk more offline about that. No, I think Brian has produces phenomenal video.
Yeah.
I thought The Skeptologist was excellent. I was so excited watching it. The production value was high. Brian's friend that he works with is awesome.
Ryan Johnson.
Yeah, Ryan Johnson is fantastic. So I'd love to do that at some point in the future. There are more things that we could do to cross-pollinate with each other and to work together. It's just time and distance, I think.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. and inability to dedicate sufficient time and resources to it. It's as simple as that.
Yeah, it's just it's resources. If you want to promote a certain worldview, you got to put resources into doing just that.
If you know what I mean.
But we get a lot of bang for the buck, and when you think about it, like we've been kicking the Discovery Institute's ass, I think, up and down the court for the last whatever 4 or 5 years, and they're funded to the tune of millions of dollars.
Yeah.
And all we have is just our dedication, really, to counter them. Yeah, I think we have logic and evidence on our side. That's always good. But that's not enough.
It's
folly to think that because you're right, your message is going to succeed.
It's not even helpful. Because
but it helps.
If you want to start garnering public mind share, nobody cares whether you're right. Dr. Oz isn't popular because he's right about everything. He's popular because he's commercial, because he gives people what they want. And if we don't do the same thing, then we can't expect to ever compete for public mindshare. We've got to find a way to give people what they want, to be commercial about delivering the message that we're delivering. And
right.
There's certainly ways that I've put a lot of thought into this, as I'm sure you guys could have. But doing things like a podcast could be as popular as any of the paranormal podcasts, for example, if we did something like game shows or radio mysteries or things like that, something that people want to listen to no matter who they are. They don't have to be a fan of the JREF already in order to appreciate the show. Those are the kinds of things that we could be doing within the limited resources available to an audio podcast.
Right.
Nobody's doing that effectively yet.
Yeah, I mean, we have no shortage of ideas and desire. Right now we are at 100% of our bandwidth in terms of time, energy, and physical resources that it takes to get stuff done.
All right. Well, let's wrap this conversation.
Yeah,
up.
Yeah. We've been a little bit self-indulgent in this conversation, but it is interesting. It's a broader concept for how do you promote a worldview. There's always got to be a financial model behind it. That's just the way it is.
I mean, I actually think our audience, both of our audiences, Brian, are very generous. You know, I'm always shocked and thrilled when we get donations of any size. And if people please contribute what you can if you enjoy our shows. And let's get back to delivering some high-end content. Like the next top 10 list. Let's do it.
Okay, let's do it. So this next top 10 list is...
Don't tell me I'm in charge.
The 10 most absurd things you've heard in the defense of nonsense. In other words, people trying to justify their beliefs by saying something especially ridiculous.
The problem with researching this is that the world of politics just yields way too much low-hanging fruit.
Yeah. It's okay as long as there's a science angle in there.
So I'll give my favorite Michelle Bachmann quote. Nothing from the recent vaccine makes you mentally retarded. But I'm not exactly sure where and when she said this, but she was debating with or complaining about Nancy Pelosi and the global warming issue. And she said she's committed to her global warming fanaticism to the point where she has said that she's just trying to save the planet. But we all know that someone else did that 2,000 years ago. They saved the planet.
Wow, that's pretty bad.
Planet is already saved.
In every possible way, from any future threat, even the ones that have absolutely nothing to do with the spiritual nature of the quote-unquote saving that she's referring to.
Yeah. All right, I've got one. One of my favorites, and we were one of the people that it was directed at. All I know is that kid disappeared.
I got that one.
Yeah.
I got that.
Tell the backstory, Steve.
This is when we were investigating Ed and Lorraine Warren, and they gave us a videotape. Them and a bunch of kids in an alleged haunted house. They were running video. This is actually went back in the day when there was actual tape. And at one point in the video, one of the the students who is working with them, like, walks into a doorway and, like, touches his head and looks at the ceiling like something just dropped on his head and then vanished from the tape. So, you know, your first hypothesis would be, well, the tape was stopped, the kid walked away, and the tape was restarted. You know, you wouldn't even think anything unusual about it. In fact, during the investigation, no one noticed anything unusual. This kid did not, you know, vanish. Nothing happened to him. He didn't go missing at any point in time.
No memory lapses.
There's no memory. There's no discontinuity of any kind. So clearly this is just an artifact of the tape. But it was an anomaly. The Warrens and the people who were working with them at the time, you know, had to exploit it as a way of saying that this is evidence that something paranormal was happening. They were investigating ghosts, and I guess somehow that would mean, yes, that some kid would dematerialize. We did a careful analysis of the tape. We actually turned it over to a company, a media company, that could look at it on, like, a high-end editing deck so you could see more information, etc. And there was clear from multiple independent lines of evidence that the tape had been stopped at the moment that the kid disappeared from the tape. We gave this full analysis to Ed Warren, you know, proving that this was an artifact of stopping the tape. And his response to that was, "All I know is that kid disappeared." That was his analysis.
And what's crazy, Brian, is doesn't that say it all? First off, it's a very bad way to start a sentence by saying, "All I know is," right? This is not a good opener. But also, because of more things that we had found out about Ed Warren, I also think he was full of it. That's him just fighting for his income, not what he believes in. Do you have one, Brian?
I've got. Am I doing 10 or are we?
As many as you have that are interesting. It doesn't have to be 10. That's an arbitrary number.
Any that I have that are interesting. Am I permitted one more from the world of politics?
Go right ahead.
This has to do with conspiracy theories. The conspiracy theory that the government was actually behind Hurricane Katrina. And this is a quote from Cynthia McKinney, who was was she a senator or a congresswoman at the time of Hurricane Katrina? She was in Congress. I don't remember whether she was a senator or not. But she held a press conference right after the hurricane, and this is what she said. So I met a woman who said her son's charge by the Department of Defense was to process 5,000 bodies that had received a single bullet wound to the head, and these were mostly males. The data about these individuals was entered into a Pentagon computer, and then reportedly the bodies were dumped in the swamp in Louisiana. I have verification from insiders who wish to remain anonymous at the Red Cross that this is true. So we have Wu from both sides of the political aisle here. She is reporting her evidence that the government was in fact using Hurricane Katrina as an excuse to round up and kill 5,000 young men and dump them in the swamp.
And how did those 5,000 bodies disappear? I guess they were all eaten by alligators?
Well, they were processed, is what the quote says.
They were processed.
Eating by an alligator, that's a form of processing.
Thankfully, she is no longer representing anybody in Congress.
Yeah. She was way more of a mess than I think most people gave her credit for.
All right, I got a couple on my list, but I want Jay to read one of them. Right here, Jay, on my screen.
I know what it is.
Yeah. The quote is, "Oh yeah."
That's number one on my list.
All right, but here, my number one on my list is the Plagiarans, the aliens from the Pleiades, only allow Billy Meier to take photos that look like fakes to avoid giving him incontrovertible evidence of their existence. So this is a stand-in for all the special pleading that we get from the UFO community that the aliens want to give us clues to their presence, but do not want there to be smoking gun incontrovertible evidence of aliens. So that's why all the photographs and other evidence are crappy. The evidence is bad. And in this case, not only is it bad, but it's made to look exactly like it's hoaxed.
Who's the quote from?
This is Billy Meyer, the Swiss.
Oh, Billy Meyer himself said this, that they only allow him to.
Yes. Yeah.
Yes. Okay.
Yeah, he's just providing plausible deniability to his believers. But that's not even the worst one. The worst one was when, and I've been writing about this recently on my blog, this is why I have these examples at hand, but the wedding cake UFO is a UFO that looks like a stacked wedding cake. It was terrible. But the base of it, the bottom of this UFO, somebody matched to a garbage can lid that was found in Billy Meyer's home. And if you look at the picture side by side, the UFO model and the garbage can lid, yes, you could see that they're identical. You know, and there's little details that tell you that that's exactly what it is. So of course the believers will say things like, "Oh, it doesn't look anything like that. You're nuts. This is whatever. You know, there's no similarity whatsoever." And then Billy Meyer, I always find this ironic. In order to cover his own tail, he also hangs out his own believers to dry, and the believers don't really see this, and they immediately flip 180 degrees and start going with whatever crappy story Billy Meyer just said. So Billy Meyer, here's his reason for why his picture of the UFO looks like it's made from a garbage can lid. The aliens were psychically beaming the plans for their beam ships, right, their flying saucers, to German scientists in order to help us develop our spaceship technology. And those psychic signals got crossed somehow so that other engineers who were designing garbage cans made the garbage can lid look like a piece of their flying saucer. So, you know, that's a perfectly reasonable explanation. It's just these psychic signals can't be controlled. They just leaked across to other engineers. That's why the UFO looks like a garbage can lid.
That's like the Scientologist saying that, or L. Ron Hubbard saying that DC-10s flew the Thetans to the planet Earth, right? The ships that they were gold DC-10s that came from all around the galaxy.
Oh, is that right?
Yeah, and where did the DC-10 design come from? Well, those ships, that design came first, not the modern DC-10 design.
This is much worse than that. This is a garbage can lid. These are German engineers who can't tell the difference between a spaceship and a garbage can lid. So, of course, once he says, yes, they do look identical, but this is why, then all of the believers who were previously denying the similarity in how they look are now hung out to dry. He did the same exact thing with the photos of Ascot and Neera, the two alleged aliens that turned out to be dancers from a Dean Martin television show. At first you're saying, no, it looks nothing like them, you're crazy, you know, really saying the skeptics are all biased and that you have to be an idiot to think they look the same. And then Meyer goes, oh no, that is a photograph of those girls, but they were planted in my evidence by the men in black. And then immediately the believers flip and go, that now is the explanation, even though Billy Meyer just said that everything we had been saying for years to defend him is bullshit.
Hearing Billy Meyer's description of his own universe makes me feel like the police department psychologist in The Terminator.
Right.
Yeah.
Exactly.
But it does also prove that Billy Meyer knows he's full of it.
I don't think
yours
it's one of those black and white dichotomies, but...
All right,
Bob, you got one?
As good as yours.
Yeah.
Yeah, I've got... this one's one of my favorites. This is like a generic response. I can't attribute this to one person, but a lot of people have said it. Yeah, but quantum mechanics says that can happen.
Yeah.
That type of thing. Just using quantum mechanics because it's not intuitive to explain all sorts of bizarre stuff, and it just doesn't work that way. And I hear that all the time. It's just so annoying.
I thought Deepak Chopra was off limits for this particular exercise because it's just too rich.
It's too easy.
Yeah.
But you just include Deepak Chopra as just anything he says fits this category. We'll just sort of give him a generic, you know, acknowledgement.
I got one. Ray Comfort said, "Behold the atheist nightmare," and this is what he said before he did the whole banana bit, where he said that banana was designed. It's proof of God because of how incredibly designed it is to fit in the human mouth and in the human hand, and he just came up with a litany of ridiculous reasons why that proves that God exists. Little did he know that the banana was actually a creation of man. It was selectively bred. It was,
it was,
you know,
cultivated.
It's cultivated for all of those
features.
For all the features, but they came out
pretty much. I mean, a lot of the features that he was talking about, either you can explain through adaptive evolutionary mechanisms, or they were cultivated specifically by people to have those features.
Right.
So it was ridiculous. And that, along with that, was the peanut butter argument. Why isn't life crawling out of a jar of peanut butter? Remember that one?
Yeah, yeah.
That's a similar one.
Well, that came out with his...
Well, he had a good point there.
You got anything else, Brian? I got one or two more, but if you give you a shot to get in here.
Where did it go? This is a little bit of a reverse one. When the Q-Ray guys were on trial way back when, and they presented all of their explanations about why the Q-Ray worked, I could say that, but the judge's comeback to them was even better. So this is the judge's comeback to the Q-Ray explanation of why their bracelet worked. The judge says, "Defendants might as well have said, beneficent creatures from the 17th dimension use this bracelet as a beacon to locate people who need pain relief and whisk them off to their home world every night to provide help in ways unknown to our science."
Well, there you go.
Kudos to a judge who would put that into his decision.
All right, I've got another one. I'm sure all you guys know this. This is from, they think it was from Bertrand Russell. Once gave a public lecture on astronomy. He described how the Earth orbits around the Sun and how the Sun in turn orbits around the center of a vast collection of stars called our galaxy. At the end of the lecture, a little old lady at the back of the room got up and said, "What you have told us is rubbish. The world is really a flat plate supported on the back of a giant tortoise." The scientist gave a superior smile before replying, What is the tortoise standing on?" "You're very clever, young man, very clever," said the old lady, "but it's turtles all the way down."
Yeah, it's a classic.
I think that wins it.
Turtles all the way down. I mean, that's become a cliche.
Yeah.
Is it apocryphal?
Yeah, is it apocryphal or is that real?
Yeah.
I just like the quote.
I'll throw in another generic one, like Bob's, you know, quantum mechanic ones. Anytime someone says, "Well, science doesn't know everything," as a defense of whatever position they're taking at the moment.
Yep. That's an old favorite. And we're all paid by Big Pharma. That's...
Yep, the assumption of a conflict of interest or being on the take.
I have one more. And I'm not going to give a lead in or a lead out. I'm just going to say it. No! One of the dumbest things ever said by Darth Vader ever. There you go. There's your clue.
Oh, yes. Yeah. I'm with you on that one. Did you see the recent, I think someone made an animated GIF of Alderaan shoots first?
Alderaan shoots first.
Brian, email me that link.
Alderaan shoots a little laser at the Death Star, which then quickly dodges, moves back, and fires and destroys.
Oh my God, that's awful.
That's why the internet is the best environment for creativity.
He just retouched his movies. He's got to wait for the next, you know, 6 months.
Yeah.
There's a whole website, Alderaan Shot First.
Yeah, maybe in a few more years he'll do a whole bit where we'll hear Darth Vader's inner dialogue where he's going, "I don't want the Emperor to kill my son. This is bad. He shouldn't do that. No."
Hey, I have a question for you guys.
Yeah.
This whole hour, I haven't had video, so I've just been listening. I haven't heard a peep from Rebecca. Is she with us?
She's napping.
What's that? How is that permissible?
Well, we all got a couple hours to lie down.
Oh.
We scheduled in. Hey, listen, I gotta tell you, Absolutely no way my brain is going to be awake for 24 hours.
36 hours, dude.
Yeah, it's really 36 hours. It's just not happening. So just rather than trying, we just scheduled in naps just so we will be functional for the show. Hey, there's five. This is the advantage to having five of us, Brian.
Official disapproval of that, and I want that to be registered.
Your disapproval?
Yes.
Duly noted and ignored.
All right. Do we have time for a couple more?
Sure.
See if you can guess what profession the person was in who said this. When you eat meat, it sits in your colon for 40 years and putrefies and eventually gives you the illness you die of. And that is a fact.
What was it? Who said that?
It's somebody who engaged in, what do you call that? Colon cleansing?
Yeah, colon cleansing.
No, it is a Hollywood celebrity. That's
what's her face? Who's Ann Summers?
Heather Mills.
Close enough.
You had me at celebrity.
Did we already cover tide goes in, tide goes out?
Or magnets, how the heck do they work? Yeah, those are all good.
I remember, Bob, when was this? It was Janet Jackson said that she was getting a coffee colon enema. And when asked, why are you doing it, she said, and it should have been one of my quotes, this is epic. She said, to wash out the sad cells.
The sad cells.
Sad cells. So. In her ass. How do you get sad cells in your ass?
How could the cells in your ass not be sad?
Well, they have the shittiest job.
Yeah.
Think about it.
Osmosis.
Osmosis. Thank you, Evan.
Oh, boy.
Especially yours, Jay.
But think about it. Think about her. She actually, somebody told her, I'm sure she didn't come up with this. Some idiot came up with, you need to put coffee in your ass to wash out the sad cells. And her brain, this is the filter system in her brain. There is mine. She goes, yeah, okay, yeah. Wash out those sad cells. Let me pay you $3,000 to put Starbucks in my ass.
It's expensive enough as it is.
Yeah, right? I'm paying $3 in the morning to get a nice cup of coffee. She's paying about $3,000 to get it put in her ass.
Right. You just want to say ass as many times as possible.
Business, I'm going to put that on my sign outside my door.
Oh, boy. There was just a review published, as if this had to be done, right? But it's always nice to have it anyway, at all of the colon cleansing, coffee enema things, and it showed that, one, there's absolutely no benefit to any of it, and two, it's dangerous. There's actually a pretty substantial complication rate
what could happen?
That.
Really?
Yeah,
like
perforate
what?
Your bowel.
Oh,
yeah.
That sounds painful.
So it's both ineffective and unsafe.
So what would be the thing that perforates your bowel?
Whatever tube they're putting up there, yeah.
All right. Learn the lesson, Evan. Don't stick things in your butt.
Got it?
That's a great lesson. Brilliant.
He sounds convinced.
Highly.
Why don't we get George in here now?
We want George Trab.
We want George Trab.
Interesting.
We want him.
Is he just going to take Rebecca's seat?
Ladies and gentlemen.
Joe, we're going to need another chair, too, when Rebecca joins us again.
I'll take care.
All right, all right.
Mr. George Rabb.
This is...
Yeah. Gio!
Yay!
Clip him on the back there.
Awesome. Perfect timing, because you are talking about ass play, so I appreciate that you bring me on right now.
Yeah.
It's perfect, because this is going to be the next, I think, 4 hours of conversation.
Right.
George, the people are writing in on the chat, how the vibraphone, very excited.
Thank you.
George is awesome. Evan, go get George some coffee. I don't know.
Who was that bald guy?
Nice.
Coffee enema.
Who is that bald guy? Oh, perfect.
Gio has a bald spot.
Yes. And it's on my ass, actually, so it works out perfectly.
George, do you have any questions for Brian Dunning?
Do I have any questions for Brian Dunning?
Yes.
What is his opinion on ass play?
Your opinion on ass play, Brian?
You know, it's 4 o'clock in the morning here. I'll just show my ass. Have I?
Okay.
Yeah, hey, this Saturday.
Someone said styrofoam. Is that a thing too?
That's if you're from Australia, you see.
I knew vibraphone. I didn't hear the styrofoam.
Styrofoam, man.
Yeah.
Okay. Whatever. No.
No.
Hey, congrats, guys. This is amazing.
Yeah,
you like the set?
And it's yeah, and it's like, and the audio is working great, and no problem.
No problems at all.
George, I was thinking,
we
are
like, about like audio.
George, yeah, we beat your TAM intro.
I was watching, and I was feeling for you guys.
Yeah,
so
yeah,
yes.
That's
so, but no, that's in the past. That was 12 hours ago. You beat the night. You beat the night.
We
you're,
did.
You're here. So yeah.
In 5 minutes, we will be at the halfway mark.
Halfway mark. Yeah, yeah. This is ridiculous. I mean, this is absolutely ridiculous.
All right, let's cut Brian loose and let the guy get back to good bed. All
right,
you know?
Brian.
I got
thanks for joining us at 4 in the morning. We really appreciate it. Keep up all the good work.
Thank you, guys. This is a lot of fun. This is so awesome. I wish I could be watching it.
Yeah, you probably can.
Can.
I mean, if you, you just don't have the bandwidth at the hotel. That's the problem.
No, actually, the bandwidth here is very good, but I was trying to give you a tip to advise the viewers every hour or so how they can purchase the DVD or see this in its entirety.
Yes. We definitely will be making this available in other formats once we see what we actually managed to record after the whole
that's
thing is
be
over.
An etching.
Yeah.
That's it? Okay. Glad I gave
thanks
you
that. A lot, Bri.
All right, guys. Thank
Take
you.
Take care.
Take care, pal.
Bye, Brian.
Bye, Brian. Right.
Get some sleep.
All right.
Yeah, we can dispose of the earplugs.
I'm going to ask our technician, are we a go on the intro?
We will try.
Okay, so we're going to try to replay the intro that started this whole thing.
With audio.
With audio.
Good.
And then if that doesn't work, we're definitely going to put it up on YouTube. So it'll be available in one way or the other soon. But here we go. We're going to try it again.
And while this is happening,
killer
we're going to save.
With audio?
Oh.
there it is. So, guys, did you hear the music?
Yeah.
Good work.
Bravo.
So that video was the result of the hard work of Jay, who essentially is directing our video unit now, plus all of the guys on the team that he put together. Jay, tell us the team of people you have working for you on those videos.
Well, my fiance Courtney, Doug Soban, who is also playing Joe Pepe and a number of other things tonight.
What do you mean he's playing Joe Pepe?
And Brian Trent, who's helping us run the show tonight as well.
And the music was done by Jake Wilson.
Music was done
awesome.
By Jake Wilson. And then all of the cool visual effects you see was done by, I just want to make sure that I'm pronouncing Ben's last name
Let's
correctly. Let me get on here 1 second. I believe it's Smith. Ben Erickson, I think. Hold on.
He did these special effects, like the
Erickson. So that took quite a bit of time, guys. That was a hard video to do, but we definitely needed a cool intro, and I just was obsessed with getting that thing done.
Yeah, it was fun.
I'm glad everyone liked it.
Jay, where was that stream your part was filmed in? Where was that?
I was in we were in Wolcott, Connecticut.
In Wolcott?
Yeah.
Okay. That was pretty cool.
Well, George,
you had Dragon Con volunteers do the Rebecca thing.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah. So when we
so
were
what happened? Like, so you just had to find elves?
Well, one guy in the video
was
a listener and was just happened to be wearing like that perfect kind of cheesy D&D outfit.
Right.
We walked up to the two Viking people. We saw them on the street, and Courtney just went up to them and said, "We're just shooting a video." Like I was really kind of tired and out of it, and she just was walking up to people like, "You want to be in a video?" Blah, you know. So they were perfect.
Like she was all in her getup already, right?
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah.
Can we videotape you in your costume?
Yeah.
And people were like,
and they were okay.
Yes.
And then the guy with the beard, he didn't even have a Dragon Con ticket. He was just literally dressed up walking around the streets because Dragon Con was happening. So I'm like,
what's Dragon Con?
And I loved him. Yeah,
right. I just like to wear this.
Cool. It's Dragon Con. I just came from an all-night party. So anyway, he showed up somehow. We got into the hotel. He was there. He was awesome.
Right.
And then the girl that had the griffin, she was at Dragon Con, totally dressed up, and we hit her up. We just happened to be walking right next to her, and we're like, "You want to be in it?" Yeah. And she had the griffin little thing. It was great. So it just, you know, we pulled people out of the woodwork, and we somehow made it work.
Was there a crowd like watching as you guys were doing this, or was there
not that many? There were people that were playing other games in that area. Remember,
okay.
We went up to the 12th floor and
where we did that. Yeah.
So there were a couple of other people. Like one, there was a dice game being played of some kind.
Yeah.
And then there was other people, like a family sitting there. And then we rolled in, and we just had lights and the whole thing. Like we had a crew of people. And like I kept looking at them, and what was so odd was they didn't seem to know we were there. There was no like, "What's going on over here?"
Right.
Like they're just in their own world. Like
right,
you know,
right, right.
A movie breaks out, you know, shooting of a movie, and it didn't seem strange to them. I guess
Dragon Con.
Yeah.
Have we hit halfway?
We
have you hit halfway?
Yeah.
Halfway.
Yeah, we're halfway.
Hey.
Yep.
How much money have we raised? Are we going to cure cancer today, or is that what's the?
We're going to cure scientific literacy.
Where's the? Can
we go to the board? We have the Skeptometer.
Yes. How is it doing?
We've pushed it back from the brink.
Yes, the forest fire will not happen.
It's now sort of fluctuating in the middle there. We're hoping to get it as far as to the yellow.
Okay. What is the logarithm that determines the what's the process for determining?
It's a very complicated algorithm.
Sure.
We have the Sound 9000,
right? And then
you know,
it uses
working
the blogging thing and
and all that.
Yeah.
It has to do with certainly how much financial support our listeners send our way.
Oh, I see. Oh, so it's a bribe. Cool. Awesome.
Absolutely. How many listeners and viewers we have at any given moment.
Gotcha.
And just the overall success of our show. The more we stay awake, the more it gets pushed towards the yellow.
Nice.
The more every time we have a cool guest on, it lurches a little bit.
So you're screwed.
We'll have to make up time
later for
this.
We got a very important question.
Yes.
It said, "Gio, does the carpet match the drapes?" What does that mean?
Where the guy? It means that he shaved his balls.
Didn't we go through this already once?
Good morning. I'm very happy to be here.
Are the pants coming off by the end of the show? Is that what we're talking about?
George, another listener said that they think we should auction you for money.
Auction me?
Yeah.
A date with George.
To benefit the SGU.
$10 is $10.
Yeah,
that's like two coffees. So
someone wants us to wave to them. Hello.
Who?
Everyone wave.
Big antlers like this.
Here's all right, so this is to the audience and not to George. George will be here for 2 or 3 hours, George.
I can do three.
3 hours. Yeah. Okay, George is with us for 3 hours.
We have a lot of stuff planned, actually.
He's going to help us stay awake.
Yes.
This, to me, like, my brain is waking up. No, this is actually not bad for me because this is, you know, like, I wake up at 6:30, 7 o'clock, and this is not bad. I'm going to be good for the few hours.
This is the hump. I can just feel myself getting over the hump. This is when you're right, like, physiologically, even when I'm sleep-deprived, like 8, 9, 10 in the morning, my body's waking up, even though I need the sleep. I felt at my worst right when I got up from my nap because I was totally in stage 4 sleep mode, and that transitioning from that is the hardest thing to do.
What are the schedules? What's your schedule like work-wise? When you go to bed normally, what's your day like?
Midnight, and I'm up at 7 every morning.
Midnight up at 7?
I'm usually asleep at 11, up at 6:30.
Freaks.
I go to bed anytime between 12 and 1,
okay.
And I'm up at 7:30.
Wow. Yeah. Bob, similar?
Go to bed between 1 and 2, wake up at 6.
Wow.
Really? You're like, so all you guys are dealing with like 5-6 hours-ish.
I try to get to 7.
7.
7. I can't do math, but yeah.
How about you?
What, like to me, yeah, it's like
5
4,
to 11?
Yeah, yeah, 4 to 11, 4 to 10, 3 to 10.
You're a musician, though.
No, I know, yeah. I know, but it's just, and man, there was a time where I worked for a college. I had to be there at 6:45, and I did that job for 3.5 years. And the last day that I had to do it was as difficult as the first day.
Yeah.
I'm just not designed. I don't know if it's because my bedroom as a kid didn't have like direct sunlight. I don't know what, because my parents get up early, my sister gets up early. Mm. I don't know what circadian theory would explain. But all right, so you guys are dealing with minimal sleep.
Yeah.
Plus, you had the whole day beforehand. That was the thing that was pretty pretty ballsy move, was to do it eight.
Ballsy, stupid.
You know, 6 and 1.
Yeah, George, some people, 8 o'clock tonight, we'll be happy. We'll be like, great, I could go to bed and sleep till noon and get 14, 15 hours sleep.
Yeah, imagine
this
ending at 8 in the morning. That's would have been a problem.
Right. George, a number of people are asking you to act like Rebecca for a little bit. I don't know if you want to do that. I don't know how you do
She's
that.
She's here. I don't know if I'd want to do that.
Okay, forget it. Okay, Rebecca is shuffling back in. So.
Everybody hates.
Oh, you got a question
here.
Somebody
said film Rebecca sleeping. That would have been awesome.
Ooh, that's good.
Do any of the SGU play instruments, and will we see any combos in the future with Geo?
Oh, jeez.
We never thought of that, did we?
Well, maybe we can do something today.
Maybe.
Stay tuned. Send money in.
Wait, as soon as Rebecca wakes up.
If we hit that $100,000 goal, maybe.
Okay, yeah, we got Rebecca coming back.
Have you made phone calls? Have you done, been working out?
No, no one's giving us we called Fred Bremer.
Oh, okay.
I mean, other than our scheduled interviews.
Didn't you auction off, like phone that you would call people
that
the show?
We're supposed to call that guy right now.
I see, okay.
The one guy who actually, there's actually two people have paid for us to call them.
Yeah.
The second person, I just emailed.
He's busy.
They sent us the donation during the show, and I emailed them and said, great, give us a number, Skype name and number, and I haven't seen a response yet. The first guy, who is David Young, who is sponsoring this segment of the show, we're trying to get him on now.
Okay.
So as soon as we can get David on, he's got a few questions to ask us.
Ooh.
And we're gonna we will accommodate him.
Yeah, and just for our listeners, if you wanted to make a donation for the show right now, you could go to theskepticsguide.org/24hourshow.aspx, or you can go to the link off of our homepage. You'll see a link there, and if you scroll down, there's a 24-hour show personal phone call that you know it's not cheap, but you know it's a big donation, but we'd appreciate it. And also, you could do the quick donations. You could be a Padawan for $5, Initiate for $10, a Jedi Guardian for $25, the Jedi Consular for $50.
How do I become a Jedi Master?
Wait,
that's what I want to know.
Jedi Sentinel for $75, and Jedi Master, it just says ?? So I guess that's anything above $100.
Yeah.
But.
Any amount.
George Lucas can go screw if he thinks he's gonna freaking. Give us shit for that.
All right, so Jedi Master. It says very easy. See, you don't have to go through all that crazy training.
Hey, Evan, we got a mic for Rebecca. What are we doing?
Nope. Oh wait, yeah,
we do.
Yeah, I got something.
All right. So, haven't gotten emailed yet from the two guys that we're trying to work on.
Come back to this one?
Wow.
Did you get my message about contacting?
Think about it. Let's see. Rebecca can help.
Oh,
Rebecca.
Just email.
Rebecca!
Okay, so...
Snooze. Snooze and
2 minutes, 2 hours.
Snooze, you snooze.
Squeeze in. Steve, you want to move over a little bit?
Mic back. Let me give you your mic back.
You could get...
I'll take the new crappy one.
You are relegated to the guest.
And you know what? I'm going to do a quick
set
clean up.
We'll make
room
for you. You have to shuffle
yeah.
that way.
Likewise.
George, you didn't kiss me when you walked down the
street. See, I'm probably going to give you...
Later, we got 3 hours.
I'm going to give you my mic because this won't reach. Rebecca, how'd it go?
Bar? Great. Topping down there.
Yeah, I'm probably
going to use
them.
Oh. I'll set it. I need some room you could slide over.
George got some sugar off of Rebecca like a boss.
That's what George does.
Wow, like a boss.
George,
and George looks
like
an angel in that light.
While
yes.
we're settling in,
don't go into the light, George.
Take care of some biological needs. We'll be back in about 10 minutes.
What are we doing about breakfast?
Right. I just
Courtney's
got a muffin.
Making pumpkin pancakes for us.
Oh,
did she
right.
mean that, or was she teasing us?
I don't know. I'm going to put off eating this muffin until I find out, though.
There you go. Yeah, you won't regret that.
Yeah.
They're awesome.
I'm a fan.
Some of the most absurd things someone said in defense of
pumpkin.
That I didn't get a chance to say with Brian Dunning. So here's my list, in no particular order. I do believe, sadly, it's going to take some disease coming back to realize that we need to change and develop vaccines that are safe. The vaccine companies are not listening to us. It's their fucking fault that the diseases are coming back. It's a product of shit. If you give us a safe vaccine, we'll use it. It shouldn't be polio versus autism.
Yeah. Michelle Bachmann.
I'm not off.
Wow.
No, it's a good guess, though. Jenny McCarthy.
The classic.
Check. Am I coming through?
Hello. Can you hear me?
No? Dead mic? Nothing?
No, according to our lovely fan.
Thanks, Shane.
What's it say or do that thing?
We got more cups upstairs, otherwise I'll recycle.
It's plugged in.
Yeah, we have more. Hey, Rebecca, we have more.
Thanks.
Check.
Nope. They can barely hear you. Wait. That might have been through the other.
Geo, somebody said you look like an angel in the light.
I'm getting.
It's a good look for
you.
You
did a lot.
How have you been?
Good.
George, you probably already went over that. So how have you been?
No, no one asked. No one was interested.
Really?
They were going on their skeptical stuff.
Yeah,
and
you know
they
what?
Just. I
they
walked
just
in, my one said hi, and it wasn't even like.
That's just like them. They get
funny.
Focused.
Very focused. They're
yeah.
talking about ass play as I walked in, and then they thought, oh, we should bring George in on this. And,
just talking, or?
Yeah, just. They were drawing something, too, which is weird, but.
Is that what this is?
George, what time did you have to get up to get here?
4:30.
Oh, my God.
I got up, which wasn't too bad. Went to bed at 2, so it wasn't too bad.
Yeah.
So you've had the same amount of sleep as the rest
just
of us.
Just about, but it's cool.
Good.
But this is, it's like, and then I have, I'm here, and then I'm going back to PA. And I have a gig tonight. I have a wedding tonight that I'm playing in Percocet, Pennsylvania. But I love days like this because it's the complete, it's like everything that I could possibly do.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. You know, it's like driving 7 hours, it's playing drums, it's doing announcements, it's being, hanging out with you guys, being skeptical. So I just love days like this.
You didn't bring along Ms. Information, did you?
No, we were thinking about it, but I had to go up to Cambridge first, then I came back down. But she says hello, she says stay awake.
Yeah.
And she got locked out of her apartment last night.
Oh, no. Poor thing.
She was dog sitting, and she walked out of her apartment and locked the door. And, of course, the person that has the extra key is me. So, but she picked her own lock with her earring.
What?
Oh, Rambo.
Sweet.
That.
So
what?
Badass.
That is badass.
Yeah,
yeah.
Really badass. I was like, good for you.
She is awesome.
Check.
Yeah.
I love that woman. I do.
Well, we have a few things on the schedule, George, that we're going to try to work in here.
Okay.
For your 3 hours, we have the top 10 list. Did you get that?
No.
No. Okay. You're going to have to wing it. We had time to prepare.
Oh, fine.
But that's okay.
All right.
And we also have the quiz show. Do we have a? That's a 10. We have a quiz show.
Wow.
And we have this musical thing that you want to do with us.
Yeah,
when
sure.
You want to do that now?
Yeah. Do it now? Okay.
Oh, we're going to do the music thing right now?
All
right.
What music thing?
Let's do it.
Did we think about how we're going to physically
do
it?
Yeah, should we try to figure that out?
Are we going to be sitting? Can we do it while we're sitting here?
Yeah.
All right, well, if I'm going to go get my instrument. Since George knows what I'm going to do.
Oh, okay, yeah. Get that, and then... Yeah, I got a bag of instruments as well.
Yeah.
I should
okay.
get that
right
then,
back.
I guess. And we'll figure out. We'll see.
Yeah.
Well,
that way we'll,
cool.
we'll have them on
we'll
stage.
We'll
while you guys do that, we're going to do something else.
Okay.
Let's see what we got on the news item
feed. Did you
guys
talk about glowing kittens without me?
Yes, we did. We
I'm
were
really
very
upset about that.
Yes,
oh,
we said that you were going to be
really
upset about that.
Really upset.
We could do it again.
I love the glowing kittens that... Cure AIDS. I mean,
what's better than that?
Cades.
Yeah, it's just a beautiful story.
Glowing kittens saving AIDS. All right, we did the emotion detector, the glowing cats, the exoplanets, and now we're up to the supercomputer that predicts revolution. This is an interesting one. This is psychohistory, Bob. Remember psychohistory from the Foundation?
Yeah.
Series? The notion that if you figure out all of the forces that are involved with, that push, you know, history in one direction or another, that you can actually model future history. I think it's a folly. It's chaos, you know, theory. But what some computer programmers did, they created an algorithm to evaluate, to monitor and score headlines, like newspaper headlines. And then they used that as a way of predicting when a country or a society is unstable, is like due to hit a revolution or a crisis. And then they applied their model to the previous uprisings in Libya and Egypt, and showed that it had some predictive value. However, so far the analysis has only been carried out retrospectively, so that's the big weakness.
Yeah.
Astrologers are really good at explaining what's already happened in the past. You know, the real test of a theory is okay, or if they look at use their model prospectively, is that going to actually tell us something meaningful before it happens? So it's not, you know, it's not crazy. I mean, because they're very limited in the scope of what they're trying to predict.
Yeah, I mean, especially over the short term.
Yeah, and it's over a short period of time.
It's like weather predictions. Short term, yeah, you can get somewhat accurate, but the further you go out, obviously, chaos takes over, and
right.
you know, you'll never make long-term predictions. What's going to happen to society and culture. But, I mean, I can see, you know, in the future, you know, helping out to a certain extent for short-term revolutions or whatever.
Right.
But
I think it probably realistically would be one marker among many. You know, if you get like two or three or four different things, that trends that you could follow that could plausibly relate to the stability of a government or a culture, that it might give at least a probability, a warning that trouble is heading.
Confidence
levels,
you know.
You can never account for this.
The mule.
Yeah, the mule. You know, there's a mule effect. In the Foundation series, there was an extraordinary individual person who completely derailed the nice, predictable history that the character had laid out, Harry Seldon. But the same thing happens. One charismatic leader can take a country in a different direction, and there's no way you can account for that in any kind of predictive model just looking at lots of little events and how they add up. The graphic I have on the screen behind me, I don't know if we're able to feed that to you, but that's actually the data from the study. And it looks pretty noisy to me. It almost looks like a stock exchange or something. Yeah, it's similar, you know, to a stock market.
It's
similar.
The same trend.
Yeah, similar kind of trend. All right, you guys ready with all the instruments?
Yeah. So a couple weeks ago, I went kind of on a rant on my show about drum circles.
Yeah.
And for those people that listen to my show. I was walking out of my parking garage and heard this cacophony coming out of an alleyway near my house. And upon hearing the rhythm that was being produced, the first thing that I thought was white people.
uh-huh.
And it was really obvious. And it was sort of this sort of hippie drum circle thing that was happening, which I'm okay with, but in a certain way it's a little insulting. On one level, because there's a lot of people that kind of get together, they have drums, and they just sort of play, they bang out rhythms, and it's fun, and it's fine. It's not necessarily accurate, and it's a little almost even sort of culturally, I don't know if insensitive is too strong of a word, but it's just weird. And
awkward.
Awkward, yeah.
What was awkward?
That these white people were playing, were in a drum circle just sort of banging out rhythms.
Badly,
and no one ever gets together with a bunch of guitars that doesn't know how to play guitar and strums guitars and goes, look, we're playing guitars, look, we're in a guitar circle. Or you get six pianos in a room and go,
right.
I'm making sound, we're in a piano circle.
Right, or violins.
Exactly. But with drums, because the sort of nature of a drum isn't quite as discordant.
Yeah.
When they're playing together.
The bar for starting to play is a lot lower.
Yeah, and plus, George, some people could naturally understand a beat and rhythm, and they could do very simple things. They could do it okay, you know?
Yeah. But what ends up happening is you get this kind of pulse cacophony where people just sort of are playing a very simple pulse. And there's a tribal aspect to that I totally get that is very fun. It's very, you know, when you do that, it's trance-like. It doesn't have much to do with sort of ethnic drumming or whatever. So Jay had the idea of maybe I could teach you guys some rhythms to show and to demonstrate actually what's happening in a lot of these, especially West African drum circle things, are incredibly rhythmically complex, what's happening. It doesn't sound like much is happening, but it's a lot of multimetric, weird polyrhythms that are happening together. It's 6 against 4 against 2 against 3. And it's really cool, and it's sort of difficult, but not that difficult. So I thought if we could have an instrument maybe, and I could try to teach you guys, and we could see if this collection of Caucasians could maybe do something that would approach a West African, maybe Senegal kind of rhythm.
I don't suppose there's a trumpet in that bag, is there? Because otherwise, I'm not going to do well.
But you're going to blast out with a trumpet, Rebecca?
I can play a lot of instruments, but the drum,
it's going to be rhythm. I mean, you can even clap if you're not comfortable. Because it's more about.
I'm not good at clapping.
You're not good at clapping?
I'm. Wow. You don't understand
how
bad.
Alien hands.
Well, we're
going
to find out. You don't have to understand.
People make me play the drums on,
Rock Band.
On Rock Band. Because it's so funny. Because I'm a monkey who doesn't understand.
No. Monkeys have much more rhythm.
Yeah, they would, actually. Yeah, that was unfair to monkeys.
Monkeys use their thumbs more efficiently than.
Yeah, it's bad. It's really bad.
Well, no, I'm going to.
I'm just going to put that out there.
There aren't many. I don't have many drums. I know. Well, that was my question, is if you guys had to rate yourself in terms of musical ability, rhythmic ability, like from top to bottom, how would you sort of rate yourselves, do you think, amongst the five of you?
I'm
going to
go bottom. Really?
One being best, five
one.
Being oh. five. And I'm sure this
oh,
is a very.
Five.
Like a 1 to 5 scale. One being the
one
out
being
of you five.
Number one, yeah. I'm
who's
number
the best
five.
Rhythmically?
At rhythm. At rhythm specifically.
Yeah, rhythm. Steve. Rhythm specifically.
I told you this before.
Right.
I play the drums.
All right.
Yeah.
So I would assume that you would.
Because I had a natural affinity
okay.
for them.
Right.
So I think that I had good
so
rhythm.
So now I know Jay was a bass player.
Jay
is a bass player.
I've always been rhythmic. Say the word for me.
Linguistically?
Yes. Linguistically challenged.
Yes.
I've had problems with rhythm in and out with my bass playing.
I just don't have a natural meter.
What's a good instrument
for that? I play by It is. No, it is. It's more forgiving. Definitely more forgiving. I mean, I
play some kind of tonal rhythm instrument. Jay.
Perfect.
Yeah. Okay.
But I did it for over 20 years, so I have very good understanding.
Well, this is not going to be you essentially have to be able to count to 6 to be able to make this work.
Okay.
And we'll do it very slow at first, and I think it'll work. I think it'll work. It may fall flat, but whatever. You know.
Lots of things on this 24-hour show have fallen flat.
No, don't worry about it. It's been perfect. All right. So
yeah, when we faked not getting online at the beginning in order to build the drama,
no, it was brilliant.
That worked out exactly
to
like
to
I planned.
To build up people wanting, you know, to draw them in that there's no audio or that the feed is cutting out. I mean, that's hard to reproduce and make it look so real.
That's right.
It's really effective.
It's a lot of planning to make it look that nice.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
Late for all this performance.
Yeah. Right.
We rehearsed this, 10 times before we got it just believable and authentic?
Yeah, to cut that video to make it look like it was stopping and starting.
Oh, man, you have no idea.
Really involved, so.
Right.
All right, so, well, Bob is number one, and then what do we think?
Steve.
Have you guys met? Steve. Yeah, sorry.
Who's tired?
Yeah, who's tired?
Well, Jay's been playing in a band for
Jay's
probably
two,
just developed.
Rex 5.
Yeah. Yeah,
and
no.
Then rhythmically, I mean, do you have any affinity?
Oh, me, I'm 4.5, dude.
Four and a half.
I'm not as bad as Rebecca, but I'm right next to her.
Okay. Just because there's something, and then
so Evans,
all right.
The middleman by default.
Yeah.
Okay. So, I don't know if I'll be able to walk and do this. I think we've got Steve's rototoms here, which are an ancient African instrument. Made out of titanium plastic.
Which I haven't tuned. Did you try?
I think we'll be fine. I'm going to be fine. It's fine.
I want to mention that I'm in the SGU chat room on Ryzen. So that is me, guys. Rebecca Watson.
Yeah, I'm in there too.
Okay.
So
now, I just want to know if it's not anybody faking.
Now, Jay, you're going to play.
I'll play my didge.
You play your didgeridoo. All right. So why don't we do this then? So.
Do a cowbell.
All right, so this is going to be...
More cowbell, yeah.
This is going to be kind of cool because we're going to be dealing with lowest common multiple as well as least common denominator. That stuff that in math that you said, when am I ever going to use this? I used to literally say, when am I ever going to use this? And when you do this kind of stuff, you actually use it because it's multimeters all lining up together.
This one right there?
All right.
Yeah, you can pull that other one out.
That one there?
Yeah, pull that over there.
Now, I'm assuming that our face mics will pick up what's happening.
Yeah, if we just put your face in the drum.
I think so. Which I'm used to.
Cool, like an animal.
I think it'll totally come up.
Bash your head against the drum.
Okay, so what we're dealing with is, in essence, this rhythm is going to be based on a 6-note pattern. So each bar, in essence, to make it simple, is based on 6 beats.
Yeah.
Okay. And we're going to be dealing with 2 subdivisions. So there's a quarter note, which is, this is your quarter note. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. And we're going to subdivide that in half to an eighth note. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. And those are the only subdivisions we'll be using for this. So Steve has to set up the basis of the rhythm, which... in 6 will be 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. And the way you do that is, yeah, just to make it effective. So we've got, so here are quarter notes, 3, 4, 5, 6. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. All right. 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Good. Good. Now, Rebecca, you have to hit this tambourine on beats 2 and beats 5.
Okay.
1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6.
I can
all right. You can do that?
Yeah, I think
3,
so.
4, 5, 6. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. 1, 2.
It's 2.
2 and 5.
5.
That's
okay.
It.
That's
1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. 1, 2. You're right. 4, 5, 6. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. because we can get another part.
No, I'm totally going to get this.
So you can do this. Is that better? That's it.
Mike, can you hear this?
One.
Testing.
Remember, this is your quarter. You got to, if you can't, it makes it easier. 3, 4, 5, 6. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Good. All right, now. 2, 3, 4, 5. All right. This will be, so you have eighth notes. Interesting.
Fun, but
so now we do. Now we subdivide, and we're gonna do a four against this. So keep thinking of what Evan's playing, and you're gonna play groups of three. One, two, three. All right. So right, left. Tell you what, Bob, do that for now. See if you can do that rhythm for now, just to get it set up, and then we'll get the. Okay. So stop right there. So hold on, Steve. All right. What happens is you get this really cool 4 against 6 against 2.
Yeah.
Once it gets a little bit faster.
What's cool about it?
What's cool is you have this. This is your rhythm, essentially, Steve's rhythm.
Yeah.
Bob, you have that under the 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3. It's crazy and it's awesome and it sounds like a cacophony. We will get there. We will totally get there. Let's do this. Let's reassign parts here.
Okay, we're working it.
Jay.
Yeah,
I can't. Because it's actually a kind of a cool rhythmic part. Okay.
When was this on?
So,
what beat?
So you are taking the subdivisions and you're making sets of three.
Okay.
So 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3. Yeah. That's it. 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. 1, 2, 3. 4, 5, 6, yeah! 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, good! 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Now what's cool is if Evan goes against, so here's the eighths. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Now Steve, 3, 4, 5, 6.
Wow.
Okay, so hold up. Let's try a little bit faster.
Oh, no.
So, but is when you see people do this, when you see West African people do this, kids, whatever, it is so sort of ingrained.
Yeah.
And they start these tempos.
Yeah.
One, two, three, four. One, two, three, four. One, two, three, four. One, two, three. And it's three against four against six against two.
Yeah.
It's one, two,
it's
three,
awesome.
Four, five, six. One, two, three. Four, one, a two, a yes. Three, a four.
And it works because those are all numbers.
Oh, yeah.
All the letters?
Is that the moral of the story?
That's the moral
is that
of the
where
story.
We're going?
Does that work? I don't know. What's the response?
Cool. I thought it was cool.
I look incredulous, according to someone.
Someone said I'm blown away.
Okay, so now what we should do is that Jay should give me a little background here. Maybe I can play something over a little bit of a didge.
Okay, I think it would sound good with some other stuff. I mean, I could rip a little bit off. I'm not going to be doing that much rhythm making on this because I'm not good
Bob,
at it.
Bob, sure. You're still in.
You know, it's going to be just more flavor, background flavor.
You just go in. Yeah.
No, yeah, this is cross-cultural, so we're going to mix West African with Australian, which is probably some kind of, puts us in a certain circle of hell, which I don't even know what it is. But that's okay. Do you have the circular breathing going?
I can do it, yeah.
Look at you, man. Wow. That's another thing. Like, if you don't realize what's actually happening when you hear a didgeridoo, you think, oh, they're just going burger.
Yeah,
burger.
No. It's
you
know,
hard.
They're
breathing, which
it's
is
hard.
So incredibly difficult. Which means what? Which means that Jay has to suck in air through his nose as he's blowing out, and then you use the muscles of your cheeks to physically press more air out into the
while you're breathing in.
While you're breathing in.
So you're actually going like that.
Right.
And you're breathing in, and you're
so it's yeah. Imagine taking a breath and blowing out a candle at the same time is what you're doing.
Yeah.
So you're breathing in your nose and you're blowing out a candle at the same time. And you're doing it through the muscles of your cheeks. So when you see these guys that can play, you know, the same note for half an hour, it's insane.
Yeah.
Yes.
So the fact that you can do that, that's really cool. Really
that's the
cool.
One thing I picked up since I got this in November.
Yeah.
So yeah.
It takes work, right?
Yeah. It was a while.
Cool. Let me hear it.
Good.
Yeah, it's good.
It's picking it up though. Did you hear that?
Thank you. Huge object. That was the end of the lesson. Thank you, George.
That was good, George.
But it's neat when you start hearing this stuff and you start realizing what's going on.
Yeah.
I saw one of the most amazing percussion performances I ever saw was at a drum conference in Ohio, and it was this teacher, music teacher, had a bunch of, I think they were like 12 years old, these kids from Ohio, and he had taught them these drum riffs from Senegal, and they were playing, you know, the right instruments, the goat skin drum heads and everything. These kids were unbelievable. They it was like second nature, like nothing was going on, which showed that there's no inherent rhythmic cliche of, you know, white people and whatever. It's all in exposure and how you're taught it and what's going on. And these kids, I mean, the entire audience, we were all just sitting there with our mouths on the floor because, first off, they're kids.
Yeah.
Let alone that they're playing something from you know, accurately from West Africa. They just demolished us. This teacher should get, you know, should get a ride on the space shuttle. It was just so incredible. I wish I knew his name. But he kind of walked out and we thought, oh, what's this going to be? Because, you know, you have the guy and he's got the dashiki on and you're thinking,
right.
Oh, this is going to be some cliched, you know, ooh, yes, the soul of the drum is in each of us or something garbage you hear all the time, you know. And he was like, this first rhythm is called whatever, and just went, gonna go do it. And it was like, what? How is this happening? It was awesome, absolutely awesome. And it taught me, like, you know, don't, it's another one of those lessons of, like, don't presume, don't judge. Yeah, you know, it's great.
We got a great comment from IRC, from Skeptic. With the console in the background, it reminds me of that episode of Star Trek where the space hippies come on board.
I remember the song.
Vulcan Meyer.
Ready?
Stepping out.
Coming
to
home to
me.
Yeah, brother.
I remember Steve and I were just talking about this episode recently.
Oh,
and
that's great.
They wanted to find this planet that was Eden, right? I guess
sure.
That's where they wanted to go. So they get to this planet, and it was... They beam themselves down to it, and I guess the Captain Kirk and everyone was like, that's not the planet to go to. That's not then the planet's not safe. So the guy beams down. This guy had like big like cauliflower ears, and he goes up, and they took these pears and they like carved a wedge, like four wedges down through a pear, and then they colored it red, and that was like the foreign fruit, like the alien
fruit.
Sure. It was definitely
modified pears. Yeah.
So the guy eats it, and it's acidic, and it, you know, melts his face off. That was a sad ending to it, unfortunately. They didn't get to Eden, George.
A lot of listeners are also...
Sorry.
A lot of listeners are thanking us for waking us up. Waking them up.
Yeah, that did help.
Well, that's why it was a good idea.
Geo Joshi says that everybody in chat thinks this is effing cool, but he didn't say effing. He said the other word.
Oh, okay.
We're not allowed to say.
Freaking? Yeah. He said it was fucking cool. Oh, I got to spin the wheel.
Yep. Get your butt over there.
Explain the wheel.
Get your effing butt over there.
Explain the wheel here for me.
Ah, well.
Oh, it's the wheel of death.
It's
the wheel
of death.
The instruments are
It's the wheel of happy fun time.
Somehow
that doesn't work as well.
I want something new.
So this is like a cursed jar?
Yeah, if it's bacon, Jay.
Jar voice.
No, you can't veto the wheel.
What are you talking about?
Oh, good.
Improv.
All right, George, give Jay a scene that he has to now improv and act out. Go. Give him something.
Oh, you're at a bank teller, an automatic bank teller window. You're trying to make a deposit.
Okay.
And what happens?
And no one's answering.
I'm at an ATM or a bank.
No, it's a person. No, drive-through. You want to make a deposit. You want to make a deposit and... you want to make a deposit and, yeah.
They're not responding.
And they're not responding.
Okay, ready?
Yes.
Mm-hmm. You want to put your headphones on?
Start over again.
Yeah.
Yeah, they might not have heard that.
Yeah, brother.
Welcome to American Bank. Can I help you?
Yeah, here you go. I got a check here. It's signed. And I'm taking a withdrawal, please.
It's a deposit. It's like there's one piece of information you need.
I'm improvising.
Okay.
Improv.
All right.
sir,
you can't
make a deposit if you're handing me a check, sir.
No, I'm making a deposit and I want to withdraw.
What do you want to withdraw, sir?
It's on the paper. Read the paper. What do you want me to tell you?
I don't like your attitude, sir. I think you should go away, sir.
Look, you're the idiot that's working in a bank. I'm here to do business with
Whoa.
You.
Actually, sir, this is an Arby's.
Are you not going to cash the check or what?
Well, I don't think I can cash the check because we basically sell roast beef sandwiches here, sir.
Well, you got money to buy roast beef. You know, cash the check. Go around. See if anybody's got cash on them. Let's go. Let's make this happen.
All right. Just wait one sec, sir.
Yeah, so anyway, Steve, yeah, the SGU24 show. I'm on my headset right now talking to Steve. I know, dude. I'm working my ass off.
Sir, could you please turn your phone off while you're waiting?
Sure. No problem. So we're working tonight and pretty much every night this week after work to tie up those loose ends.
Wait a minute. You're not on a novella, are you?
Why, I am. Yes, I am. Thank you.
We're closed, sir.
All right, that's good.
That
that'll be
good.
Good job.
End scene.
That skit was brought to you by Arby's.
Comments, yeah. Comments include, this is awesome, hilarious.
That broke like every improv rule, too.
Horsey sauce.
There are rules.
Oh, yeah, you're supposed to agree. Always agree.
Yeah, always agree. There are no notes.
Oh, yes, of course.
Yeah.
But
right. Really?
Yeah.
Say the F word again.
That's the only rule.
Did I?
Did you watch it?
Oh.
No. That's no.
That's no.
So hardcore, Steve.
Mike, are we getting David online?
David who?
Are we getting David online?
Or should we do
my son David?
We do it either
my son David. You didn't listen to my son David. He saved the whole planet. My son David did.
Excuse me. Is that character Jewish?
I don't know.
Independence Day. Friggin' what's his
name?
Oh yeah. You know, it's like really. Judd Hirsch. Yeah.
Yeah.
You wouldn't be here without my son David.
Are you playing a Jew?
What is this, aliens?
Judd, that was great, but could you make it Jewier?
Yeah, can you make it more Jewy? More Jewy. Really? You want me? No, really. Just
my son David.
Seriously?
Yeah, roll it.
Whenever someone says David, it's the first thing I think.
What is this, end of days?
In this movie, I fight the devil.
We're trying to get David Young on. He's in Hong Kong, and there are some issues.
In Hong Kong. You're like freestyling. You don't even realize that you're freestyling.
Oh, I need.
We're getting David Young on in Hong Kong.
From Hong Kong.
Hong Kong. Sing a song. Ding a long.
We've been trying for a real long time. And but he's got some internet access issues.
He's in Hong Kong? Seriously?
Yeah.
Cool.
Internet access issues?
And it's up to Mike to make him answer his Skype.
More female guests.
The trilobite came out the ocean.
Yeah.
Like in addition to me and Rebecca, or?
Except the volume of everyone went down.
We missed a couple of.
We missed a couple. We have Sarah Mayhew and Pamela Gay coming on later in the show.
Yay.
We missed Surly Amy because of technical difficulties.
Oh.
To start. And Bug Girl was going to be on, but now she's at a conference. Yes, unfortunately.
What's she doing at a conference?
I don't know.
What is she, a scientist or something?
Yeah, work.
Right, people are saying they can't hear us.
Mike, they can't hear us.
That's good enough for me.
You can hear? Okay. Well, while they're trying to get David on, let's see what's next on our news item feed. This is a good one. We can talk about this for a few minutes. You guys recognize the picture on my Star Trek-like console?
Oh, yeah, this is Tracks.
It's not Star Trek-like.
Astronaut
it
Tracks.
Is Star Trek.
Yeah, yeah.
No, I'm pretty sure
did
we
you
can
look,
get
did you look
that.
In the viewfinder?
Is this the... do we have a... Is this, like, Pon Farr porno? Like, what's going on here?
You'll be amazed at what you've seen. Is that fabulous or what?
Oh, man.
Yeah, she's good, huh?
She's really flexible.
That's quite a data readout,
wow.
Huh?
You like our Sal 9000?
She's definitely 18, though, right?
Oh, the Sal 9000 did not scan George.
That's right.
Hold on, I'm thinking.
I don't think we have the CPU resources for Sal 9000.
I'll reboot it.
Right.
I'll reboot Sal.
Right.
We'll get that
Did
going.
Did you know that the guy that played Hannibal Lecter, what's his name?
Yes.
Hopkins.
Based
Anthony Hopkins.
His character of the voice characterization of Hannibal Lecter on How.
Oh, is that right?
Yeah. And if you listen to it, it's like it's totally How.
Yeah.
Very good, Clarice. It's like, oh, that's brilliant.
Because it's creepy.
Oh, my God.
It's creepy. It's way creepier than being Grr.
Oh, yeah.
Just
passionate.
I love that character.
Oh,
my God.
So what we're looking at here is
footprints.
Picture of the moon, a close-up of the Apollo 17 landing site. This is by the Lunar Reconnaissance Vehicle, which has been getting closer and closer to the surface of the moon. And as it gets closer,
the pictures get higher and higher, well, resolution for the area that it's viewing. So here you could see not only the descent stage of the Challenger, but you can also see the footprints of the astronauts as they walked to a couple of different locations. And you can see the tire tracks of the lunar rover, and you can see the lunar rover that they left behind. I mean, it is smoking gun evidence.
It's an impressive fake is what it is. It's a very impressive fake. To simulate, you know, that is very impressive.
They could have sent a robot to the moon in the late 60s and had the robot walk around to simulate footprints. That's much more likely than actually sending people.
Yeah, that makes sense.
Or maybe the wind blew some rocks that
into
rolled.
Footprint-like shapes.
That look like lines, that look like footprints.
Well, that's been one of those comments. Like, why can't we just point a telescope at the moon and just look at the remnants?
Okay.
It's like,
right.
Okay, how's that?
Like this?
We'll send an orbiter to go look at the remnants.
An exercise in moving the goalposts.
Exactly.
They said, yeah, why don't they point the telescope at the moon? And there's a very good reason, is that the telescopes weren't designed to see something that close up, and you know, to resolve that well, and also just most telescopes that we had up until even now, like pointing an Earth telescope at the moon doesn't get you that kind of resolution.
Right.
You know, it just doesn't. So, which may not be intuitive when you actually, you know, because you think, oh, we're looking at things millions of light years away. Why can't we look at something a quarter of a million miles away? But you say, well, you can, but you just the amount of magnification that represents is just greater than what our telescopes
have. It's like sitting an inch away from your TV screen.
Yeah.
And going, do you like the movie? It looks great, right? And it's like, I don't know.
So, yeah, there are some instruments like the Hubble. I think like the Hubble couldn't even be pointed at the moon because
right.
it would be too much light. I mean, just it would overwhelm the sensors, whatever is designed
right.
for looking at, you know, very distant objects. So in any case, we started to have orbiters reconnaissance vehicles sending back pictures of the landing sites, and they, you know, so there. Well, there you go. There's a picture of the Apollo 11 landing site, and they said, well, it's you know, it's too fuzzy. It's not detailed enough to tell for certain that that's what it is, which is, you know, it's always. Denialism is always fun intellectually because how eerily similar it is to skepticism. It's not skepticism because it's got the process backwards. It's starting with
right.
the conclusion and then
right.
working backwards. But they borrow the same style of
yeah.
argument, and sometimes they're even borrowing our phrases now and our analogies. They're pseudo-skeptics. You know, it's like they would take what we would say about a blob squatch photo, you know, a blobby, fuzzy, indistinct photo. That's
blob squatch.
You guys haven't heard that one? Blob squatch?
Yeah.
And they apply that to this
yeah.
kind of evidence. Yeah, but, you know, it's different. There's some very specific
mm.
details here that we can see. And as we get closer and closer, unlike the face on Mars, where
right.
as the resolution went up, its resemblance to a human face went down. Here, as the resolution goes up, we get to see more and more details that fit exactly with the mission descriptions of the Apollo mm-hmm. missions. And
it's like science in general.
Yeah,
you
exactly.
know, the more you look at something,
yeah.
the clearer it becomes
yeah.
in some ways.
In some way, either existing or not existing.
Yeah.
But it clarifies one
right.
way or the other.
And it supports everything
yeah.
that's come previously.
Right.
Yeah.
And
so
what
supports everything that's come
what
previously.
Direction you're moving in, is it getting less like a face or
right.
more like a face? Is it getting more like a primate or more... Like a blob or whatever,
right?
Or is
right.
it in this case we got exactly
a
what you would
site.
Predict from
yeah.
the fact that we actually landed people on the moon?
Yeah,
moon
the tracks are what kill me.
The footprint.
Yeah, they
yeah.
tell
yeah.
you in the tracks. That's what just
yeah.
me, that's going to be
there. What are they saying
forever,
about
it?
Yeah. What are they
essentially forever?
Right,
right.
And that shows people were there. I to me it's not like it proved people were there. To me it's I knew people were there, but that's like it's like a beautiful artifact of feet. You know, sloshing through the regolith, right? It's awesome. Like to think that people made those marks.
It's like that feeling you get when you're a kid and you've walked across a newly snowed
yeah.
lawn, and you kind of think like, oh, like I was there. Like those were my prints. That's really cool. Like because you're 10 or you're 7
yeah.
or whatever it is, and that's just neat that you think, oh, my dad and I just made those footprints. Or
yeah.
whatever. Like this is the adult